We're already at lecture 26. We have a few of these left. So if you really want more, just let me know. How many of you attended the seminar today? That's a good number. Did you like it? Yeah, a lot of the topics we covered in caching, at least, was covered over there. It's amazing that people are still working on caches, right? But as Moin said, when constraints change, then the way you design caches should probably change also, right? If your cache is 1 terabyte, maybe you need to rethink the design of the tag store, because you don't want to design a huge tag store for that. Maybe you can keep the tag store in memory just like you discussed, right? Anyway, that's something good to think about. And actually, he mentioned heterogeneous memories, which we will talk about in lecture today. OK, but before that, let's make sure this is working. It's not working, I guess. Maybe I finally ran out of batteries. Maybe my USB port is not working. Wouldn't it be nice if it automatically diagnosed and told me what is wrong, right? That would be a very nice contribution. What part of the system went wrong? OK, let's start with some good news. Lab 5 honors. Who thinks who's at the top? He or she's at the top. Who thinks he or she's second or third? No one? There's got to be someone. Derek and Abhijit, no one's here. So there were, I think, 7 working designs, right? Fully working designs with critical path. So you get 0.3%. Prin gets 0.5%. Elena, she's not here, 0.7%. Amanda, she didn't even realize it. So that's good. That's a good thing. Yeah. Well, this is a critical path competition, right? Is that right? Yeah. And Jipeng and Raghav got the best critical paths, unexpectedly, obviously. Well, I guess you could get lucky, that's true. You could get lucky. Maybe we should have more formal competitions. But even if you got lucky, that's good. You somehow optimize your design by luck. But this is a little bit harder, probably. That's the 4-way cache design. And I'm glad several of you submitted it. Some of the designs did not work. So if you think your design worked, you should check with Kevin. Xiaofan? you did submit, but your design didn't fully work, I think. If you disagree with that, Kevin is over there. Pete? Your design didn't fully work also, but your documentation was very nice. And these designs actually worked, Raghav, Junhan, and Kais. And Jared got the best timing in terms of number of cycles, and had a good documentation also. These are actually pretty good extra credits. This is the entire course grade. Not that you care about grades, but. OK. So where we are in the lecture schedule, I want to finish, hopefully, memory today. There's a lot to cover, but hopefully it's not that hard to cover some of this material. And I'm going to go over some things that we've covered before anyway. Remember, we were talking about prefetching, so I'm going to finish prefetching. We were talking about different kinds of prefetchers. And then we're going to jump into emerging memory technologies. And some of this is already covered in your required reading, at least at the high level. So remember, we were talking about a lot of questions in prefetching. We covered software prefetching, and we covered some hardware prefetching algorithms, next line prefetcher, stream prefetching, stride prefetching. I want to continue that. OK, that's not going to work. And talk about some other prefetching algorithms. And this was the last slide that I left you off with. We talked about prefetchers that cover regular patterns. And this is actually relatively easy to do. But what about irregular patterns? If your addresses seemingly have nothing to do with each other in terms of a stride or multiple regular strides or a stream, right? So we'll first talk about address correlation-based prefetching. Let's assume that your program has this kind of cache block addresses. These are misses that you get. A, B, C, D, C, E, A, C, F, F, E, A, A, B, C, D, E, A, B, C, D, C. If you look at this, if these addresses have nothing to do with each other arithmetically, then it's difficult to prefetch with a stride prefetcher, right? But it may, if you look at this, if you look at, for example, what comes after A, well, usually B comes after A, right? Actually, in most of the cases, more than 50% of the cases you see A, you see B coming next. So you can correlate between these two different addresses. Basically, after referencing a particular address, some addresses are more likely to be referenced next. And you can actually build a graph if you see this access tree. And let's assume that a probability graph of transitioning from one address to another address. Right? This is called a Markov graph or Markov model, more formally. Basically, this shows you the probability of seeing address B after you've already seen address A. Right? The 60% probability you will access B. If you access B with 100% probability, you will access C next. And if you look at this, BC, BC, and BC occur. And that's, C is the only address that's accessed after B. Make sense? So you can actually exploit this insight to build a prefetcher that correlates between the addresses. And why does this happen? Actually, there may be some data structures where this is even more strong, right, than what I've shown you over here. So if you have a linked list, for example, and whenever you, the linked list is static, and each node, you basically traverse the linked list from head to the end all the time, you always see the same accesses, right? Let's assume that the nodes are at address A, B, C, D, E, F, G. Whenever you traverse this linked list, you access A, B, C, D, E, F, G. So the first time you access the linked list, you record the stream, and the next time you start accessing the linked list, you can actually prefetch the entire stream of addresses that have nothing to do with each other arithmetically. Does that make sense? It's clear, right? Let me actually show you the picture, since that way we can test this, because I might use this in a little bit. Okay. Oh. Does that work? Okay. So assume that, remember, we looked at linked lists in the last class, actually, when we talked about run-ahead address value delta prediction. This said address A, B, C, D, E, F, dot, dot, dot. The first time you traverse this linked list, you get all misses, A, B, C, D, E, F, dot, dot, dot. Now, when you go next time, if you record this somehow, whenever I accessed A previously, the next one was B. If I accessed B previously, the next one was C. If I accessed C previously, the next one was D. If I accessed D previously, the next one was E, dot, dot, dot. So if you have a table that records this information, the next time you see A, you index this table, and the table tells you, oh, the next access should be B. Then you can prefetch B, right? And then maybe using that prefetch, you index that table again. Oh, if I actually access B, what would be next? The next would be C. So yeah, maybe you prefetch C. And then you make believe that you're going to access C also. You index this table. And then the next access that's predicted would be to D. And then you prefetch D. And then you can keep doing this over and over, right? That way you can prefetch the linked list once you see A, assuming this correlation is strong. Does that make sense? So that's the idea over here, basically. That is also called a Markov prefetcher. And you can actually imagine extending it in many different ways. Here, I stored only one address, for example. After A comes B. But you can actually think about storing, oh, the previous time I saw A, the next three accesses were to B, C, D. Right? So you can store all of these addresses. And then when you see address A again, you prefetch B, C, D right away in a single entry. You can go crazy, and you can store a million addresses that come after A, right? If you're confident enough, it may be OK. Right? That's the idea, basically. And this is the picture I showed you down there, basically. Record the next likely addresses after seeing address A. And next time A is accessed, prefetch those likely addresses. And in this case, A is said to be correlated with B, C, D. basically, whenever you see A, you access B, C, D with some probability. And you can actually assign probabilities also. So if you look at this figure over here, with probability 60%, you access B. With probability 20%, you access A again. With probability, is this correct? No. Okay. The remaining probability, 20%, you access C. You can actually record these probabilities as confidence levels and maybe decide to prefetch one or two or three next blocks depending on your confidence level. Is this clear? It's pretty simple, right? And if you want to increase coverage, you can actually prefetch up to n next addresses. You don't prefetch just one, but you can actually prefetch up to n. Or index into the table again with the prefetched addresses, and then find what will come after these accesses if I actually really use them. Okay? And one downside could be accuracy, of course, right? If you actually prefetch many things over here to increase coverage, that's a classic trade-off between coverage and accuracy in prefetching. If you want to increase coverage, you want to prefetch more and more. But then this impacts your accuracy because it becomes less and less likely that you're going to use those things. That's true in a prefetcher like Stride prefetcher or Stream prefetcher we discussed last time. If you want to increase your coverage, you want to increase your distance, right? Prefetch distance. But then that impacts your accuracy. You can be 1,000 blocks ahead, but then at the end of the loop, as we've discussed last time, all of those things that you prefetched last time would be useless. So your accuracy is impacted. Here you can do the same thing. By prefetching more, you increase your coverage. So how do you improve accuracy? So accuracy, actually, you can do another trick, which is actually interesting. Multiple addresses can be correlated with what comes next, right? So you increase your confidence a little bit. Instead of just looking at A, instead of just correlating A with what comes next, you look at a little bit more. Oh, the next time I saw AB in sequence, the last time I saw AB in sequence, the next address that came was C. Now you have to see A and B, maybe in sequence or maybe in some vicinity of time, to be able to say, oh, I want C. That increases your accuracy, right? It's not enough to just see A. It's not enough to just see B. You need to see A and B together. And can again, increase your accuracy, but then this probably impacts your coverage. That's the trade-off between accuracy and coverage. Yes? Yeah, you can do it for both instruction and data. All of these techniques are actually...
Yeah, but like commonly.
Oh, commonly. So these are, again, as we discussed last time, instructions are easier, in a sense, right, to predict. This is mainly for pointer-based data structures. Actually, that was one of the reasons why this was proposed. And you can imagine this working really well in a linked list like this that you keep traversing a million times in a program, right? Once you record it, the next time you never get cache misses on that linked list, right? Even if those addresses are scattered all over memory. Of course, let's take a look at some of the difficulties. And this is a really nice paper that introduced this idea. And because of this paper, it's also called Markov prefetchers. Let's take a look at the advantages. Well, one big advantage is it can cover arbitrary access patterns, right? It doesn't need to be, there doesn't need to be any arithmetic relationship between the addresses. If there is arithmetic relationship, it works also, right? Well, if you're streaming through memory, again, you can construct this table. No, it doesn't work well. Let's say your accesses are like this, A plus 4, A plus 8, A plus 12, A plus 16, dot, dot, dot. And you do this over and over in the program. Well, first time you see A, the next thing you see is A plus 4. You record that in the table. If you see A plus 4, the next thing you see is A plus 8. If you see A plus 8, the next thing you see is A plus 12, dot, dot, dot. So these could be part of your Markov table or correlation table. And then the next time you see A, you prefetch A plus 4. The next time you see A plus 4, you prefetch A plus 8, dot, dot, dot. So this can actually be as efficient as a Stride prefetcher. Well, not as accurate as a Stride prefetcher, right? But is this efficient? Not much, right? Because you now really have a single entry for every address that you see. Whereas a Stream prefetcher or a Stride prefetcher, you just need one entry saying, this is my last address and this is the Stride. So I keep adding to that address. As a result, you can be much more efficient with it. You can capture this kind of access pattern much more efficiently with a stream or stride prefetcher. You can do it with a Markov prefetcher too, except it becomes very inefficient. And that's actually the Achilles heel of this kind of prefetchers. You need to have this correlation table that stores, if I've seen this address, what is the next address? Or if I've seen these n addresses, what are the next m addresses? That's the more generalized form. But this could be, actually in general, it needs to be very large for high coverage. So imagine a linked list with a billion entries, a graph with a billion entries. That's a lot, right? That's huge. How do you form the correlation table for that? If each entry, basically you need a billion entries, right? To be able to get full coverage. And I'm assuming that all of the access to the graph is a miss, actually. Does that make sense? Yeah, so that's the big downside of this. Recording every miss address and subsequent miss addresses is infeasible. So people actually simplify this, and simplifications actually reduce coverage. We're not going to go into that. The other downside is it can have low timeliness. Basically, your look-ahead may be limited since a prefetch for the next access or next miss is initiated right after the previous, right? But we kind of talked about this briefly. So if you actually do, if you prefetch, let's say, when you see B, if you prefetch only one thing that comes right after it, maybe it's too late, right? Because you're going to see C soon after, maybe. So you need some look-ahead. So to be able to look ahead, basically you can prefetch more. That's, again, another fundamental technique. It doesn't matter what kind of prefetch you use. If you prefetch more, your look ahead increases. That's one technique you can use to increase your look ahead. But then, if you increase your look ahead to improve your timeliness as well as coverage, now you're starting to consume a lot of memory bandwidth as well, right? Because your accuracy reduces and you're wasting bandwidth. Because some of these may not be used. And some of these may not be used at the time you're prefetching them, right? And then you may be actually delaying some other request that may be needed earlier, right? So this becomes a problem, especially when these Markov model probabilities or correlations are low and small. Okay, so you can see that there is a huge design space here for this kind of prefetcher, right? And people have actually improved upon these ideas, and some of the improved versions of these ideas are actually in some of the processors today. Oh, I should have asked you this question. Ah, what kind of misses can this reduce? It cannot reduce compulsory misses, right? I think it's kind of obvious, hopefully, because to be able to correlate between addresses, you have to have seen those addresses before. If I want to record B comes after A, I have to have seen both of them before, right, in that sequence. Now, this may be good if you have a pointer-based data structure you keep traversing, but this is one big downside of Markov prefetchers for capturing this kind of pattern, right? Oh, what happened? How did it do that? Full document camera rate display. All right, well, I don't know how to fix that. Maybe the display died. Okay, let's try it again. All right, anyway, we don't need it right now. Let's delay the fetching until we need it. That's a demand-based fetch. Okay, so basically, if you have an access pattern that's striding or streaming A+4, A+8, A+12, Markov prefetcher cannot reduce compulsory misses. It cannot latch onto that stride, right? Whereas a stride prefetcher, it doesn't need to see all of those addresses. It just needs to figure out the stride, and then it can actually prefetch for those addresses that it has never seen before. Okay. Make sense? Let's take a look at another idea. So this is one good idea that can actually potentially prefetch for irregular addresses. I'll give you one other idea, and actually we've briefly talked about this before. If you want to prefetch for pointers, and maybe you don't even have this correlation between pointers, or you don't know very well. And maybe you want to reduce the storage. So that's a big problem with Markov prefetchers, actually, the storage. How do you reduce that size? Well, you can actually get away without storing anything. And that's the nice idea of content-directed prefetching. Basically, whenever you fetch a cache line, identify what are the things that look like pointers in that cache line and issue prefetches for them. Make sense? It's kind of nice. And this is the paper that talks about it. The big advantage, there's no need to memorize or record past addresses. Actually, this is stateless. Right. And it can eliminate compulsory misses also. Never seen pointers, because you don't need to record them. You prefetch a cache line, and there are some pointers you've never accessed, so you can also prefetch for them. Right. Well, the downside is this. You can make it more intelligent, but the baseline mechanism is it indiscriminately prefetches all pointers in a cache block. As a result, what if you don't use some of those pointers? Again, you lose accuracy, you lose bandwidth efficiency. Right? Let me give you an example. So how do you identify pointer address? We briefly talked about this before when we talked about address value delta prediction, right? If you remember. How do you identify them? One way is actually compiler telling you, oh, this is a pointer. That would be nice. Then you would need to have one bit associated with some memory location, saying that this is a pointer, right? Now that becomes like typed memory. We don't have typed memories today. It would be nice, actually, for various reasons, if you have memory locations and somehow you had some bits allocated corresponding to those memory locations telling you what type it is. Right? Pointer is a good type to have. That way you can, for example, do better garbage collection as well, right? Because the garbage collector can quickly check these locations, bits, and say, oh, these are the pointers, and I can do something with them, right? So there are a lot of benefits to having memory, these metadata associated with data in memory that tell you about what the data is. That could be one thing over here, but we don't have that kind of memory. We cannot say what's a pointer and what's not. So one thing you could do is you can do what we've discussed before, right? Compare the address size values within cache block with the cache block's address. So you're accessing this cache block, you have an address, and you have all the data values inside the cache block, and you compare your address to the data values, and if the top bits match, oh, the data values are likely to be pointers. Okay, if the most significant few bits match, then declare that it's a pointer. I'll give you a quick example over here. Let's assume that, ignore this part for a while, let's assume that this is the address we're accessing. Assume that it's a virtual address. We access L2, of course, there needs to be a translation that happens, and then you access DRAM and eventually get the cache block. This is the virtual address of the cache block, and these are some of the address size values. And ignore some of these over here. Now, if you would like to identify what's a pointer in this cache block, we want to compare the top bits of each address sized data over here to the top bits of the address. That's the comparator. And this tells you what is potentially an address that's within the range of the address that you're accessing. And it looks like there's a match over here, right? The top 12 bits of this address size data value matches the top 12 bits of the virtual address that you use, virtual address of this cache block. And as a result, the content-directed prefetcher does this comparison and generates a prefetch. Does that make sense? It's kind of a cute idea, right? Because this way, you don't need any information almost. You're just guessing that this is a pointer that you might access in the near future. If you don't access it, well, too bad. You generated a wasted bus transaction. Yes?
How likely is that, or is that, like, is there a security risk there? Is there a likelihood that, like, you cause too much inefficiency because of
the prefetch? So when you say you cause a page fault, when you generated the prefetch, right? It caused
the
page.
Yeah.
So in general, when you do prefetching, because it's purely speculative, even if you get a TLB miss or page fault, those are not handled.
Okay.
Yeah. You basically drop the prefetch.
Okay.
That's the beauty of being speculative, right? Yeah. So normally, you don't cause page faults with prefetches. Now, you can under the hood if you don't actually, but that leads to a lot of complexity, right? And it could lead to some security vulnerabilities also. Somebody can actually deny service by doing this kind of prefetching, maybe, right? Especially if you can do it in software. Okay? But that's a great question, actually. Okay. Well, there are interesting things over here, right? For example, if you're doing it at the L3 cache level, you need to somehow propagate the virtual address and compare the virtual address. You cannot do this at the physical address level, right? Because your pointers are really virtual. But your cache access address at the L3 level may not be, well, is not virtual in today's systems, right? So you need to actually somehow propagate the virtual address of the cache block here and compare it to the virtual addresses. You don't compare it to physical addresses. Okay, execution-based prefetchers. So this is actually the most general form of irregular prefetching. And the idea is very simple, although the implementation may be complex. These prefetchers pre-execute a piece of the program solely for prefetching data. Think of this as a thread that you form, that you distill to basically generate a small part of the program that leads to cache misses. That's the idea. You don't need to execute the full program. You just need to execute a pruned part of the program that can lead to cache misses. And this is called a speculative thread in general. And you can consider it a thread. And in many cases, it's a thread that you launch on some place. It can be executed on a separate processor core. It can be executed on a separate hardware thread context. And it can be executed on the same thread context in idle cycles during cache misses. Hopefully, this should ring a bell, right? This is like run ahead. Yes?
Can I ask a question on context-based prefetching?
This one, yes.
You look at the pointer, but you only find out whether it's a pointer, like guess whether it's a pointer in the fetch state, right?
In the what state?
Fetch state. Like, that's when you have access to it, right? So where do you guess?
So you guess when you bring the cache block into the cache, right? You bring this cache block into the cache, you know its address, and you know all the data values here. You compare the address to all data values.
Oh, you don't do it in the pipeline.
No, you don't do it in the pipeline. This is all in the memory system. Okay? It's a cool idea. Okay. So you can actually execute the speculative thread in different places, right? And these actually have different trade-offs associated with it. And we're going to not go over a lot of them, but I'd like you to think about it. For example, if you actually execute on a separate processor or core, then the prefetch latency that you save may be less, because the cores don't normally share the L1 caches, right? They have a shared cache, but you can only prefetch into that shared cache, and the other core can benefit from that. Whereas if you share a hardware thread context, then now this thread causes more contention, right? The speculative thread causes more contention to the main thread, but now the benefit from prefetching may be higher because you bring data all the way into the L1 cache, right? Okay, so there are many questions related to this. Remember the four questions: what, when, where, and how. Let's take a look at how. How do you actually construct the speculative thread? Again, there are many design options. You can do it in software, hardware, or cooperatively. And we'll take a look at some of these. Or you can actually use the original program without any construction, but execute it faster without stalling and without correctness constraints. Again, you should be thinking run ahead here, right? Run ahead does exactly this, right? That way you don't need to construct the thread. That's why it's inefficient, though. So if you can actually prune such that you just pick the instructions that lead to cache misses, you can construct a much more efficient thread. So the key is the speculative thread needs to get to the cache misses much before the main program does, right? Otherwise, this is not very useful. So it should really avoid waiting or stalling, or it should compute less. So how do you do that? Well, we'll take a look. First of all, one benefit it has is you need to execute only those things that lead to the cache misses. So basically, only those computations that lead to cache misses. If you're actually doing an addition that affects just the data values, you can actually get rid of that, right? You don't need to put that into your speculative thread. And you can actually do branch prediction. Because this is a speculative thread, you can eliminate branches maybe, right? Assuming that your branches are very predictable, you can say, oh, I'm not going to do the branch computation, so I'm just going to do the address computation. Now, this may or may not be a good idea, depending on how predictable branches are, right? And you can also do value prediction. If some value is unknown, but if you think that it's stable when you're constructing the thread, you can actually predict that value and make your thread more compact. And again, it's purely speculative, so there's no need for recovery of the main program if the speculative thread is incorrect. That's the beauty of pure speculation. So let's take a look at this at the high level. This is how I like thinking about it. These are slides from Craig Zillis's paper, actually. So basically, you have this main program. Let's take the load first. You could do it for any problem instruction, actually, but we're talking about prefetching. So you have this load that would otherwise cause a cache miss. If you can actually fork a thread early on, much before you reach this load during execution, fork a thread that basically does executes those instructions that lead to executing that lead to the address generation of that load, and generates the cache miss much earlier than when you would actually generate it, and places into the cache, you can actually overlap the latency of this cache miss, as well as the address generation of the load, with the execution of other stuff in the main program. Right? So by the time you get to this load, this speculative thread has completed execution, prefetched the data that's needed by the load into the cache, and the load hits in the cache. And then you save, hopefully, a lot of time. Does that make sense? That's the key idea over here. And you could do it for branches. We're not going to talk about that, but you could actually, again, form a backward slice of instructions that actually lead to that branch and fork it earlier before you get to that branch, and maybe this is a hard-to-predict branch. This thread executes all those instructions and executes the branch and provides a prediction. And this prediction, when you fetch this branch, you actually use that prediction instead of using the branch predictor. And hopefully, this prediction is a lot more accurate, assuming that, well, if that thread exactly has the values and exactly executes the instructions that lead to that branch, then actually this prediction is correct, right? Unless some other processor messed with the values in the meantime, right? Yes?
Since now there would be more context switches, would it affect?
Yeah, so that's a good question. Basically, it depends on what you mean by context switches. If you actually execute all of this in the same thread context, then you will have context switches, and this may be a bad idea. But if you actually have, if you actually execute this on another core, then you save a lot of, you don't have the context switch problem, right? If you already have thread context, basically, this may not be a problem. Now, you may be causing contention if you're executing things at the with some shared resources. This speculative thread will definitely contend with the main thread, and that's definitely an issue. Make sense? Okay. So there are many issues here, and we're not going to cover all of these. Otherwise, this will be a lecture on speculative threading, if you will. When you take 740, we can have that lecture. But basically, where to execute the pre-computation thread? We talked about this before. If you do it on a separate core, you get the least contention with the main thread, but we may not get a lot of benefit. Separate thread context on the same core, you get more contention, but you get more benefit also. Same core, same context. Now you have limited things you can do, right? You execute the thread only on stall, so your benefit may be limited in this case. Although you're maybe the most efficient in terms of the hardware context usage. You're really using the context that you're otherwise not making progress on. When to spawn the pre-computation thread? This affects your timeliness, right? So you can insert the spawn instructions well before the problem load. So if you can take this fork point much further over here. Well, if you do it too early, again, you have this problem. Prefetch may not be needed because your accuracy may go down, actually because your branches may take you not to that load, right? They may take you to some other path. And maybe you prefetch too early. Even if you eventually reach that load, you prefetch too early. And by the time you get to that load, that prefetch is kicked out from the cache, right? And then maybe you're causing pollution. All of the things that we've discussed before with a large prefetch distance has the same problems, right? Again, if you put the spawn point too late, prefetch may not be timely. Right? Or you can actually do it when the main thread is stalled, right? Spawn the pre-computation thread. When do you terminate the pre-computation thread becomes an issue also, right? So you can actually be intelligent about it. For example, you can insert cancel instructions, and we'll see very briefly an ISA changes to actually enable this. Or you can figure out, oh, this thread is not very effective, right? And you can imagine some feedback related to this. For example, in run-ahead, we've discussed it, right? If run-ahead period is not going to be useful based on what happened when you entered run-ahead mode on that particular load, you can decide, oh, I'm not going to enter run-ahead mode with that load again, because in the past, when I entered run-ahead mode with that load, at that program counter, it was not useful. So there are many issues related to pre-execution. We're not going to be able to cover this, but if you're really interested in this, this is a really nice paper by a CMU graduate, actually, CK Look, that talks about how to do this on a simultaneous multi-threading processor with software-controlled prefetching. So he looks into software-controlled prefetching here. Yes.
What are the things with same core in different contexts? Like, how does that work?
Well, same core, different contexts? Basically, if you have multiple threads, think fine-grained multi-threading.
Sorry, same thread, context on the same core, yeah.
Think run-ahead. When you stall the main thread, you launch. Either run-ahead is actually a speculative thread, as we will see. But you can actually, when you stall the main thread, you can switch to this speculative thread, right? Well, it's a different thread, right? You can actually switch to this thread that's prefetching when you stall in the main thread. You get a cache miss. You actually bring in this thread that does prefetching for you. Okay? You can do it even when you don't get a cache miss, but that's not necessarily a good idea because then you have the context switch overhead, and the main thread is actually making progress, right? Think of this as a thread. Like, it's a separate thread. You can execute anywhere, anytime, right? Now, it may not be beneficial, but it's really a threat in the end. And we'll see that you actually fork. So if you look at this paper, this shows some potential places where you can actually get a lot of benefit from this. For example, if you're going through multiple pointer chains, linked list 1, linked list 2, linked list 3, linked list 4, and while you're traversing linked list 1, maybe you prefetch for these three linked lists, right? When does this happen? Well, imagine a hash table. A hash table contains each entry in the hash table may have linked lists, right? And when you're indexing into one location, one bucket in the hash table, you're really traversing those linked lists to see if you have a match. Well, maybe you have another query into the hash table in the same thread that the same thread is supposed to service. You can actually start that other query going into some other bucket and do that traversal on some other thread, right? While you're actually traversing in the main thread this particular one with this particular pointer chain. Does that make sense? You can think about it a little bit. I'm not going to go through these, but another potential example is this is your main thread. If you look at this, you have a bunch of function calls. While you're doing this function call, maybe you start a speculative thread that does the next function call, right? Speculatively. Eventually, the main thread will go and do all of these function calls. But the hope is that when the speculative thread does these function calls early on, it actually generates the cache misses that are going to be generated by this function call. And by the time the main thread gets to that, you get all cache hits. Okay, let's look at an example over here very briefly. But this is an example from a very popular program. It's called MCF. It's a vehicle scheduling program, actually. And apparently, it spends half of its time in this loop to schedule vehicles. And it's a linked list-based program. Basically, if you look at this, it basically schedules some trips. If you look at these loop iterations are independent of each other. And this traversal over here goes through a linked list. So what you can do is, while you're traversing this linked list, you can launch a speculative thread that does the traversal of the next linked list. This is very similar to what I've shown you over here. While you're traversing this linked list, a speculative thread can be launched to actually prefetch for this linked list. How do you do that? Well, let's assume you have this instruction called pre-execute start. When you get to this instruction pre-execute start, it says start pre-execution from the end of the for loop. Basically, before going into this linked list traversal, you say pre-execution thread should start executing from here, which means that it should go into the next iteration. Make sense? So it should go to the next iteration, which does the traversal of the next linked list. And you have a pre-execution stop, and when the pre-execution thread executes this part, when it reaches pre-execution stop, it should stop execution. It should terminate. This is very simple. With just two instructions over here, actually three over here, 1, 2, 3, you can launch a thread that does the traversal for the next iteration. You can actually imagine doing this more sophisticated. You can do multiple iterations, but we're not going to go over this. And this is the support you need, basically. Pre-execute start. It requests an idle context to start execution at that start PC. And you can potentially specify the maximum number of instructions to execute. This is kind of a cancellation mechanism. If you're executing too many instructions, maybe the thread is not doing, thread is consuming a lot of resources, right? And then you can see over here, so thread ID holds either the identity of the pre-execution thread or minus one if there is no idle thread context, right? So you need to have an idle thread context to be able to execute it. Pre-execute stop, the thread that executes this instruction will be self-terminated if it's a pre-execution thread. Otherwise, there's no effect, right? So you certainly don't want to terminate the main thread with pre-execution stop instructions. And there's also a cancel instruction, which is interesting, which is not present over here. Basically, terminate the pre-execution thread with thread ID. And this instruction has effect only if it's executed by the main thread in this case. And why would you want to do that? Well, what if the main thread already reaches the load that you've already started the thread to pre-execute for? Then it kind of makes no sense to continue executing that pre-execution thread, right? So you can actually cancel. Or you can cancel with some other metrics. Okay, so the results, let me give you results, and this is kind of the reason why we're talking about this, because this is actually very effective. If you, this is the execution time. The left stack bar for each application shows the execution time on the baseline machine, and the right one shows the execution time with prefetching, with this kind of prefetching. Now, unfortunately, it doesn't work really well here. Execution time increases with this one. But you see that there's significant gain on some other workloads. This is a minimum spanning tree that we've discussed earlier, right? You see actually 36% performance benefit. You see significant performance benefits if you have this kind of support in the system. And these are not necessarily the most optimized versions. Okay, so how do you construct the speculative thread? I'll very briefly talk about it, but there are actually really nice works that have examined this. So for example, if you have this instruction, that's a cache miss, and this instruction is a branch miss prediction, you can actually form the backward slice. The compiler or someone, maybe the hardware, you could actually build hardware to analyze this also. It becomes expensive. But you can go back and form the data flow graph that feeds into this problem instruction, let's say, that leads to cache misses a lot, and figure out which instructions in the past have an effect on the address that's generated by this instruction. And then you can form a slice. And then the next decision is actually where to put the fork point such that that slice gets executed as a thread. So let's take a look at it. First of all, the fork point. You need to determine a fork point, not only a slice, but you need to also determine where to start the execution of that slice, right? And in general, you would like to do it earlier such that by the time you execute this load, its cache miss is prefetched. So you can see in this example that the fork point is put outside of the function. This is the function that we're looking at, add to heap. Here, before the function is called, actually way before the function is called, you start the fork point. And let's take a look at, I'm not expecting you to understand all of this, but this is, in the end, what you need to do. This is the assembly code for the function that I showed before. And this is the problem instruction. If you look at this is the load that's the problem that caused a lot of cache misses. If you actually look at all the instructions that that affect the address of the load, it's a lot. But you can actually take this slice, do some optimizations on it. You can eliminate a lot of the instructions. And in the end, this is the pruned slice. These are the instructions that you really need to execute to get a good prediction on the for both of the problem instructions, both the load and branch over here. So you can actually, the key takeaway is you don't need to execute all of these instructions to generate the cache miss and to generate the branch prediction. You just need to compute the slice that actually affects those values. And in this case, for example, it says, is it 7 instructions? Something like that, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And actually, there's a loop over here such that you can go keep going ahead. So it's about 7 instructions. If you want to be more aggressive, you can be more. You can actually start predicting values, right? Because this is purely speculative, again. There's no correctness requirement on this thread. The goal is to just to generate cache misses. And if you can get to it quickly, maybe that's a good idea. So disadvantages, well, there's still disadvantages to thread-based execution, right? You need a context. You still execute instructions to get to it. So similar disadvantages run ahead. Run-ahead doesn't need a context. But you can imagine doing run-ahead on a separate context also. In fact, IBM Power 6, the way it does run-ahead is when you get a cache miss, so it is a multi-threaded processor. When you get a cache miss, you don't actually, you keep the main thread context, and you spawn a run-ahead thread that starts from where this cache miss left off and executes instructions in the main program. So you kind of duplicate the main program. One becomes speculative. The other one stalls for the cache miss. And the speculative program is really a run-ahead thread that's executing on a separate thread context. That way, you don't need to flush the pipeline at the end of run-ahead. You still need to you keep going executing instructions. Make sense? You don't actually waste the useful work that you already have in that thread context. It's a nice idea. If you have a separate thread context, you can optimize even run-ahead, right? Okay, any questions? Yes? Yeah, if you're doing it on a different core, you're right. But IBM Power 6 is multi-threaded.
Same core,
yeah. So it actually benefits from the most of what you have in run-ahead. Yes?
So if your loop in the speculative thread is much shorter than your loop in the main thread, wouldn't this mean that your prefetches keep getting like further and further ahead?
That's right, exactly. That's why you may have a max instructions limit, okay, like in the previous paper. You're absolutely right. You can basically you need to control the distance regardless of how you're prefetching. Distance, if you get too far ahead, then you may have problems. It's good. You guys are asking a lot of good questions. Okay. Well, I'm not going to go through run-ahead, but basically I'll point out that the idea of an execution-based prefetcher is you pre-execute a piece of the program or prune program solely for prefetching data. Run-ahead, basically, the only difference is you pre-execute the main program solely for prefetching data, right? Now I can think of advantages and disadvantages of run-ahead versus other execution-based prefetchers. Again, we're not going to go through that. And maybe there's another idea that one of you actually mentioned in a past lecture briefly. Can you make run-ahead even better by pruning the program portion executed in run-ahead mode? And you can by taking advantage of pure speculation. For example, it's purely speculative in run-ahead mode or in any of the threads over here that we've discussed. The goal is solely to find and generate the cache misses that would otherwise stall execution later on. So the key question really is, how do we achieve this goal most efficiently when with the highest benefit? So if you can somehow find and execute only those instructions that will lead to cache misses, then it can be very efficient. The how is still an open question, actually, how you do that. And I'll let you think about it. You can actually do this in systems today. If you're interested, you can let me know. It's actually fun to think about it. Okay, any questions? Yes?
Would you have to do run-ahead for the same set of instructions again and again?
What do you mean? In normal run-ahead?
Yeah, so you're looping,
uh-huh,
and you do run-ahead for the same actual set of instructions.
Yeah.
Then probably you can note down which are.
Exactly. So now you're generating ideas that could potentially answer this question, right? If you actually keep executing the same code over and over and over when you go into run-ahead, maybe you can record those things, and you can record which instructions actually were useful to generate a cache miss, and you can maybe compute even the backward slice of those instructions. And then the next time you enter run-ahead on that program counter, you just execute those instructions. That's one way of forming the speculative thread in hardware. That's a good idea. I like that. OK. So maybe this is a good time to actually take a quick break. I know it's early, especially for you guys, but it's really a natural break before we move on to emerging memory technologies. Let's take a 3-minute break, and then we'll actually cover really fast some emerging technologies. So we'll talk about emerging memory technologies. And I'll give you some slides that we've seen before to motivate the problem. Basically, this is the memory system, right, we've talked about. I'm going to go through these really quickly because these are slides that you've seen, right? We need more capacity, bandwidth, and quality of service from the memory system. Energy and power is a key concern, and DRAM technology scaling is ending. And we've talked about the DRAM scaling problem. I'm going to jog your memory. I'm going to go through this relatively fast again. Why is there a problem? Because it's difficult to reduce the size of this while keeping it reliable and efficient, right? That's the key problem, actually. Once you reduce the size of the capacitor, it becomes less reliable. It needs more refresh, for example. Once you reduce the size of the transistor, it leaks more. again, it requires more refresh, and it becomes more vulnerable to errors as well. It becomes more vulnerable to disturbance, for example, as we've discussed, right? Remember, we talked about the Rohhammer problem, if you will, the DRAM disturbance errors. Now, some of you have read the paper, so I'm going to go through this again very quickly. If you keep hammering and roll, activating and pre-charging over and over, you can induce errors. And this is an evidence of the scaling problem that actually exists. So the problem is actually real. That's why these emerging technologies are actually right now very interesting to computer architects and computer system designers. Basically, if the memory technology that you have currently are having such errors, maybe it's time to reconsider the technology that you have to design a much more reliable and maybe efficient and maybe some other, another technology that has a lot of other benefits. And this problem has been happening relatively recently, as we've discussed, right? Electrical disturbance is very, very fundamental. It happens whenever you actually try to put these electrical devices together, right? There are interference effects. If you put them too close together, then their isolation properties reduce. As a result, when you actually increase the voltage on one, the values that you store on the other, or the things that are, or on things that are close by, get affected. That's really very fundamental. It's, again, really isolation, right? Basically, you cannot isolate things really well if things are too close together, if cells are too close together. And you cannot isolate things really well, especially if things are charge-based, right? Charge electrons are actually very flaky. They can escape quickly, and you can affect the electrons that are close by you very easily if you actually apply a high voltage, right? That's one of the problems with a technology like DRAM. So these things have been known for a long time, but now things have become so close to each other, the cells have become so close to each other, as a result, their effects, it has become difficult for the DRAM manufacturers to actually screen for these effects. As a result, you've seen these Rohhammer errors in the last few years in the field. And actually, this is not a good problem, as we've discussed again. This is to jog your memory. Why is it important? Because it has a lot of impact on how you build the system on top of this, right? If your hardware is not secure, if you do not even get the property of memory isolation, the fact that whenever you read an address, you should not really affect anything else in the system other than getting the data, right? If that property is broken, if you can actually change the data by just reading from an address repeatedly, then you can have things like this, right? Someone can design an attack, some hacker, like Google Project Zero, can actually design an attack that can take over the system. And this is just one implication, right? It's some other people can design some other attacks, perhaps. And this actually, you can read about it. If you search for Rohhammer, you'll see stuff like this. People talk about it a lot these days. But it's nothing, as an architect, it's nothing new in a sense, right? It's electrical disturbance, and it's become much worse. And as a result, the manufacturers were not able to prevent it. So what do we do about it? We don't want to design systems such that somebody always breaks into the system and they just don't work, right? So how can we fix the problem, and how can we design the memory systems of the future? Basically, how do you solve the problem? Let me give you some high-level solution directions, and we'll pick one of them and discuss in more detail. One is to tolerate it, right? Basically, you can say, oh, the fundamental problem is the DRAM we have is not intelligent. It doesn't even do error correction today. So why don't we build controllers that do a lot of error correction? That may be a good idea, right? Or you can actually rethink a lot of the interfaces also. You can say maybe DRAM should, for example, similar problems exist in flash memory. Flash memory, actually, as I told you before, it's surprising that that thing works. Because when you manufacture flash chips, raw flash chips, most of the bits don't work. So what makes it work is actually the controller. It stores a lot of error correction codes with each flash page, and it corrects those bits that do not work. Flash memory is very much prone to similar read disturbance effects, actually. Whenever you read a flash page, you disturb the other pages in the block. In fact, even more so than DRAM. But the controller has error correction that corrects these errors. As a result, it's very difficult to do these attacks, the Rohhammer-like attacks in flash memory, because flash memory is really protected by this controller. One thing you can say is, oh, we know all of this, so let's make DRAM that way also. Design DRAM controllers that are a lot more intelligent. Interfaces that are a lot more intelligent also. And you can do that, and that's a very good solution direction, and maybe we'll talk about it. And maybe in the meantime, you add more functions to the controller, right? The controller can do other things as well. Maybe the controller can orchestrate data movement within DRAM, right? If you're already designing a controller that does a lot of stuff, a lot of things for managing. It can, for example, do more intelligent refresh, right, as we've discussed. That's basically the controller that we talked about. That's a more intelligent controller that's aware of the properties of retention time of different rows in memory. As a result, it adapts the refresh rate to what is needed by those rows. So these are actually the same approach to solving the problem. Tolerate the problem by designing more intelligent systems. And you can call this system DRAM co-design, right? DRAM is not just a dumb device anymore, but you're really designing a system around it to protect it. And that's just like flash memory. An SSD is a system by itself, right? The flash controller is controlling it. That's just like hard disks. Hard disk has a controller. In fact, now once you have a controller that's intelligent, you can actually do computations in it also, right? Okay, so that's one potential solution direction. And that's good to explore, probably. The second direction is maybe we should eliminate it, right? This is too tough of a problem. Maybe we should look at some other technologies. And this is what we will talk about. Basically, maybe we can replace DRAM or minimize it in the system if we have a different technology that's better than DRAM. And this may require some system-wide rethinking of how we view the memory technology and maybe the storage as well. And we'll talk about that. The third solution direction I will not talk about, but I think it's very, very promising also, is embracing it, right? Well, we have all these errors, let's live with them. It's actually maybe a more radical thing. embracing when your credit card is stolen easily by someone, embracing it may not be that easy. But for some domains, this may be OK, right? Maybe what you can do is there's some error-tolerant data. And maybe most of your data is error-tolerant. And you map it to some memory that's not so reliable, that you didn't verify, you were so sloppy, but you wanted to market it such that people can actually develop some applications, right? But then you also design very, very costly, reliable DRAM and map your critical data over there such that no one can touch it. Right? For example, your page table should probably not go into this sloppy memory, if you will, right? But this is not an unimaginable solution direction if you can actually design it well. So this can actually lead to new usage and execution models, right? If you can actually do this mapping nicely. It may be more difficult, certainly, because it's really breaking the current model that assumes memory is always correct, right? OK, and you can maybe imagine other solution directions. But these are the three major directions that are being investigated. Actually, these are investigated whenever you have scaling problems with technology, right? That leads to reliability and energy issues. But it's clear that whatever you do over here, you need to cooperate between the software, hardware, and devices. And that's what I would like you to take away from this course, as you know, right? That software-hardware cooperation. It's very difficult to do any of these solutions without cooperation between the devices, hardware, and the software. For example, intelligent refresh that we've talked about. How do you figure out the retention times? You need to have some information from the devices somehow, or you need to extract it. And certainly new usage and execution models, right? How do you figure out what is critical data, what is not critical data? Somebody needs to tell you that. It's very difficult to figure it out. Well, you could figure it out after the fact, after an attack perhaps, but you don't want that perhaps, right? OK. So let's take a look at, I'm going to bash DRAM a little bit, although we're going to get back to DRAM and talk about how to tolerate it in a later lecture, probably a guest lecture. But there are problems with DRAM as main memory today. One is we want more capacity, but capacity is hard to scale. As we've seen, as you scale the capacity of a DRAM chip, refresh rate becomes a big problem, for example. And you can imagine solutions to it, but maybe there are other solutions. Energy and power is a key system design concern, but DRAM consumes high power due to leakage and refresh, right? This is a problem. And as we've discussed, technology scaling is ending. So can we do something about it? And we've discussed some potential solutions, tolerating DRAM, enabling emerging memory technologies, or embracing the problem. And we'll see hybrid memory systems that try to do both. And we'll get to it in a little bit. So I'll go through this quickly, because I've already talked a lot about it. Basically, how do you tolerate DRAM? You overcome DRAM shortcomings with system DRAM co-design. Right? You design new DRAM architectures, interfaces, and functions, intelligent controllers. And maybe you do better waste management, right? This may not get rid of the rope hammer problem, but if you want more capacity, you shouldn't waste capacity to begin with, right? Maybe you do better compression in memory such that you don't waste a lot of capacity. If all the pages that you're storing have zeros in them only, well, maybe you can use one bit to designate zeros, right? Instead of storing gigabytes and gigabytes of zeros. This is a real problem, by the way. You can analyze your pages and figure out what fraction of them are zeros, or mostly zeros. And let me know what you find out. So there are several issues to tackle. We need to reduce energy and improve reliability at low cost, improve bandwidth and latency, reduce waste, and maybe enable computation close data. So we will discuss some of these later in the lectures, and you may actually see some of these papers. But in this lecture, we're going to talk about basically completely getting rid of DRAM, hopefully. We're not going to be able to do that, so we're going to propose what we discuss in the next slide. Basically, it turns out there are some technologies that are really interesting today. And they are fundamentally different from DRAM, and I'll tell you how they are fundamentally different. They're resistive. They're not charge-based. They're really resistance-based. As a result, they're more scalable, and they also happen to be non-volatile. Whenever you write to them, they don't lose data for years. One example is phase change memory. We'll take a look at that in more detail, but it's expected to scale to much lower values than what DRAM was expected to scale to. It's expected to be denser than DRAM because you can actually store multiple bits per cell. Whereas in DRAM, it's very, very difficult to do that because it's very difficult to control the charge in DRAM. The problem is these technologies have shortcomings as well. The key question that we will try to ask in this lecture is, can we somehow enable them to replace, augment, or maybe even surpass DRAM? That may be difficult, of course. So I'll talk about some of these things. And in the end, I'll kind of argue that there is no technology that is good at everything. Remember, we had the ideal memory before, right? Zero cost, infinite capacity, infinite bandwidth, zero latency, maximum reliability, and you can probably add to that, right? Well, I have not good news for you. There's no technology that's good at everything. That's why we have these hierarchies today, right? SRAM, DRAM, flash, and then disks. Right? But even at the memory level, main memory level, if you look at DRAM and a technology like phase change memory, DRAM is good at some things. It's fast and durable, but it's expensive, leaky, volatile. Phase change memory can be large, is non-volatile, and can be low cost, assuming scaling is better, right? Because the scaling, the size of the cell actually affects your cost in the end. Of course, your manufacturing ability also affects your cost. But the hope is that people can develop those manufacturing plants that can manufacture this kind of memories. So I'm going to sidestep that issue for now, but that's actually a really important issue. But it could be slow. It actually wears out, as we will see. And wear out means basically if you write to it, at some point the cell dies. Why does this happen? It happens in flash, for example, right? The cell reaches the end of its lifetime because in phase change memory, for example, contacts degrade because whenever you write to a cell in phase change memory, you're inducing a lot of heat current. As a result, over time, your reliability degrades. And after some number of writes to the cell, you cannot read from it reliably. So DRAM doesn't have that problem. Or at least we don't know if it has that problem, right? Maybe it does, and maybe it will. But so far, it's not that big of a problem. Whereas phase change memory, after 10 to the 6 writes in some prototypes, you cannot read from the cell. Flash is much worse, actually. Flash, after 10 to the 5 writes, cells die. Actually, much less than that, like 1,000 writes to a block, the block. You cannot write to it or read from the block again, reliably. Even after all of these error corrections that you apply. Okay, so a good idea, perhaps, is to have multiple types of technologies in main memory and design the hardware and the software to manage the data allocation and movement between these technologies to achieve the best, to maximize the greens as much as possible while minimizing the reds as much as possible. And this is the idea of hybrid memory systems. And if you attended today's talk, it was all about hybrid memory systems, right? You had a 3D stacked DRAM that's fast, that's high bandwidth, that's low latency, but that's small, and that's costly. the talk didn't cover the cost aspect, but a 3D stack DRAM is actually very, very costly. It has to be small. And it actually has other characteristics. But it can, because it's 3D stacked, it's high temperature. Actually, you need to refresh it even more. That's one of the downsides of 3D stacked DRAM. Because it's, you're stacking it with a controller, it becomes, there's no place for the heat to escape, really. And your refresh rate needs to increase. But you can have that for speed and high bandwidth. And you can have regular DRAM over here, right? Assuming that scale somehow. So this hybrid technology idea, hybrid memory system or heterogeneous memory system idea is very general. Whenever you and this is the general idea of heterogeneity, in fact, right? If you have multiple metrics to optimize for and different technologies or different techniques that are good at some of those metrics, well, why don't you combine them in a heterogeneous way and try to manage them such that you get the best of both technologies? Thread cluster memory scheduling, if you remember, it's a similar thing, right? You have these different policies that are good for different things. Well, if you want to get the best thing, fairness and throughput at the same time, you combine these different scheduling policies and apply them to the threads that benefit from those policies. Right? At the high level, the heterogeneity idea is very, very powerful. The key question is, how do you do it? OK, we've covered DRAM, so let's talk about phase change memory, what it is. And let's talk about first requirements quickly again. We want everything, right, in memory system. But traditionally, we want higher capacity, continuous low cost, higher bandwidth, dot, dot, dot. And there are some new trends. We want technology scalability, which leads to lower cost, higher capacity, and lower energy, hopefully. We want energy efficiency and quality of service, as we've discussed a lot. So there are places where emerging technologies can help. And I'll call them non-volatile memories also. They can provide higher capacity because they're more scalable. Because they're more scalable, you can get continuous low cost over time. Basically, this repeats kind of the same thing. But then you also potentially can get energy efficiency. And we'll discuss why. So what is the promise of these technologies? As we've discussed, we may be, it's likely that we need to replace or augment DRAM with a different technology because of the issues that we have with DRAM. By the way, similar things may have happened with flash and hard disks also, right? Hard disk actually had a lot of issues. They're not exposed to the system. But there's this other technology, flash, right? And it had a lot of good characteristics. And right now, you see flash eating away hard disks a lot, right? You don't have a hard disk here, for example. Right? I don't think you have a hard disk in here, right? So it's not all, actually, the application drive is another thing. Applications are also driving things in a different way, right? Applications don't want hard disks in here because hard disks have huge form factors, right? But flash is pretty reasonable for this. That's something I did not talk about. But so there are two things. It's really the technology scalability and the application drive. Applications are needing something. They're really pulling the technology in some way, and or pushing the technology in some way. And the technology itself is also not scaling. As a result, maybe it's time to examine emerging technologies, right? OK. But basically, you want a technology that's at least similarly efficient, high performance, and fault tolerant, or can be architected to be so, right? So we'll talk about how you can do that. And some emerging resistive memory technologies appear very promising. And we'll talk about mainly phase change memory. But spin torque transfer magnetic memory is very interesting. Actually, the early versions of this was developed here at CMU by Jimmy Zhu in the Data Storage System Center. Memristors, which you may have heard of, are interesting too. And that maybe there are other ones too. The key question is, can we somehow enable them to replace, augment, or surpass DRAM? Let's start from the fundamentals quickly. So what's the fundamental difference? It's really the way you store the data. If you look at DRAM and flash, they're charge memories. You write data by capturing some charge, Q, and you read data by detecting some voltage, right? That's essentially what charge sharing is. Well, even the name charge sharing, you have to have charge, right? Resistive memories, on the other hand, you write data by passing some current into it and by changing something, some structural thing, not the level of charge. And you read data by detecting the resistance of the change you've caused. So it's very different. But you're really detecting a state, structural property, if you will, rather than how much charge you have. So charge memory is limited because it's actually difficult to place and control this charge. In flash memory, which we have not talked about, and I'm not going to talk about, unfortunately, in this course. It's actually a really good topic. Maybe we'll have another lecture just for fun on flash memory. Who wants that? Who would attend that? Well, it looks like we have a lot of customers already. Okay. Who wants to attend a lecture that you would be tested on the exam? Let's see who's. I guess the answer would be different for that. That's what I guessed. Basically, flash memory looks like this. You have this floating gate, and you actually store the charge. The charge level in this floating gate determines whether you store a 0 or 1, or a 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1. Basically, you can store multiple bits per cell by chopping this charge range in the floating gate into more than one bit. In DRAM, and we've seen that, you have this capacitor charge and transistor leakage, right? And as you reduce the size of the storage unit, the charge storage unit, in this case it's the capacitor and the transistor, well, it's the access unit, but you can think of this as the storage unit together. In this case, it's the floating gate. Reliable sensing becomes difficult. And imagine you have only a single electron, right? Well, sensing that electron is very difficult, right? That's the difficulty here. The resistive memory technologies operate in a different way. In phase change memory, I'll very briefly cover these and then go into more detail in phase change memory, because I know more about this than others. But then even then, I discover I don't know enough. Emerging technologies are an area where you may always think you know, but may be difficult to figure out exactly what it is. But I'll try to give you the fundamentals. So in phase change memory, you need to inject current to change the phase of a material, a particular material. And the resistance of the material is determined by the phase. By detecting the phase, you can now actually figure out whether you stored a 0 or 1. A STT-MRAM, which we will briefly talk about, you inject the current to change the polarity of a magnet. Right? If the magnet is aligned with a reference layer, that's a 1. If the magnet is not aligned, then it's a 0. That's how you determine the resistance. In memristors, which I understand the least, you inject current to change some structure, atomic structure, and resistance is determined by the atom distance, basically. And there are other sorts of it, so this is kind of a general explanation. And if you want to learn more about these, you should really go and read the papers associated with it. I'd be happy to talk to you about it. But let's take a look at phase change memory. Basically, this actually, it turns out it's really old technology. In the 1960s, it was developed, or late 1950s. And you actually use it in your rewritable CD-ROMs. You have phase change material. Did you know that? No? Well, now you knew something. Basically, you have this phase change material, chalcogenide glass. It exists in two states, amorphous and crystalline. Amorphous state happens to have low optical reflectivity and high electrical resistivity. Crystalline state has exactly the opposite. And rewritable CD-ROMs actually take advantage of this. By shining light, you can actually determine whether it's amorphous state or crystalline state, right? As a result, you get really nice. Well, you can store data. You can actually read the data. But you can also distinguish these states based on their resistivity. And this is how it looks like, basically. You can have a heater that you can heat this chalcogenide glass material to change its state. Right? And you can abstract this as a storage element. And you can actually have an access device that determines the resistance. So it's basically resistive memory. The two states are distinguished between their resistance levels, if you want to use it as memory. If you want to use it as a storage device like CD-ROMs, you can actually do this, but then reading becomes much slower, right? So there has been recent improvements in these access devices to detect resistance. That's why these have become much more interesting to be used as memory today. If you did not have this access device, if all you were doing is shining light and actually figuring out how much reflectivity you have, that would be really slow for use for memory. But for use for memory, if you can detect the resistance really quickly, you need to have this access device. And that's why this has become much more interesting today, even though it's a really, really old technology, at least 50 years old. Okay, but then we're not going to talk about those access devices. Those are really low-level, device-level improvements. Okay, so how does this work? Basically, you need to be able to write to this device. And writing a 0 or 1 is basically setting or resetting. Is simply changing phase via injecting the current. So if you look at this graph, if you want to set, you need to inject sustained current for a long time to heat the cell above this temperature for crystallization. And if you want to reset, you heat the cell with very high temperatures to melt it above a melting temperature, and then you quench it quickly. Actually, that's it, basically. To read, you need to detect whether which resistance level you're at, amorphous versus crystalline. And I'll give you some pretty picture. Basically, this is the set state. It's low resistance, so you can actually push through a large current in it. And this is the reset state. You have very high resistance over here. And they actually usually are, it's not very fundamental, but the main difference is whether or not you have this mushroom cloud over here. Okay. So how does it work? If you really want to understand how it works, you need to go and see how the device operates. But we're going to abstract that. We're architects right now. So what are the advantages of this technology? It turns out it scales better than DRAM and flash because it requires these current pulses which scale linearly with feature size. And expected scale to 9 nanometers. And this at the same time when DRAM was expected, ITRS projected that DRAM would have issues scaling below 35 nanometers. And it was actually prototyped at 20 nanometers by IBM in 2008. DRAM is being prototyped at 20 nanometers today. That's 2015, right? Let's say 2014. It can be denser than DRAM because you actually store multiple bits per cell due to the large resistance range. Right? You can say this, let's assume that your resistance range is from 10 to the 4 to 10 to the 6. You can say 10 to the 4 to 10 to the 5 is 0. 10 to the 5 is 10 to the 6 is 1. Now you have 2 bits, right? But you can actually go finer grain. You can divide each of those bins into 2. Now you have 4 bits. You can go even more finer grain. As long as you can detect the differences in a finer grain level, you can store many, many bits per cell. That's what flash does also. But it does it at the voltage level, right? It does it at a charge level. It's non-volatile. It's actually shown to retain data for more than 10 years at 85 degrees Celsius, which is pretty good for storage. And there's no refresh needed, low idle power. The refresh problem goes away. Would be nice, right? Remember, this was the main scaling problem of DRAM. So let's take a look at some properties of this. So this is actually from a paper that we did when I was at Microsoft Research. And I'll briefly cover what we've done in that paper. And actually, these technologies are closer to reality than you may imagine. Maybe it's not going to be phase change memory, but it may be something else today. Actually, I'll talk about STT-MRAM very briefly. So what are the properties of this? And it's actually difficult. Whenever you're dealing with emerging technologies as an architect, this is a very risky kind of research or risky kind of exploration. You can think of it as starting a startup, right? You want to build a startup that comes up with phase change memory devices, right? SSDs using phase change memory. How do you do that? Well, you need to lay the groundwork, first of all. You need to do a technology survey. And that turns out to be difficult by itself because you don't know enough about the technology, right? It's not even existent in many cases. People have done prototypes, perhaps, and they reported some things, but it's not clear whether those are correct. So we did this technology survey. So I'll give you the high-level bits. Basically, latency of phase change memory, if you look at this graph over here, these are the latencies of different technologies that we have today. SRAM, embedded DRAM, DRAM, phase change memory, this is assuming some processor frequency, of course, if you can see over here. Phase change memory latency is very similar to DRAM, right? And it's non-volatile also. Whereas this is flash, this is where flash and hard drive fit. So it's much better than flash. So this is what you can see. Read latency is 4 times that of DRAM, but 1,000 times less than flash. Write latency is 12 times that of DRAM, and I don't even put flash over here because flash is actually really slow writes. Write bandwidth is actually less than DRAM, as you can see. So there are actually a lot of negatives if you see these reds. So latency is a bad news over here. Energy is also a bad news, dynamic energy, because you need to actually heat the material significantly. In fact, some of those temperatures are ridiculous. You need to put it beyond 650 degrees Celsius. That's one of the downsides of this technology, by the way. That's one of the major reasons why it may not be successful. But it's good for you to know. Basically, that's why you expend a lot of energy. So to be able to do writes, you need to spend 43 times more energy than DRAM. But the energy is actually similar to flash over time, right? The energy you expend. Endurance, that's a problem, unfortunately. To be able to change the phase of this material, you need to actually expose it to these high temperatures. And at these high temperatures, the contacts degrade due to thermal expansion and contraction if you do this. And if you do this a lot of times, the cell dies, basically. You can only do so many writes per cell. The good news is really the cell size, right? The cell size actually scales really nicely. And that's the technology scaling part. OK, let me abstract this. Basically, you can think of, as an architect, you can think of this as these are the pros. You get better technology scaling, non-volatility, low idle power. So the pros are actually pretty promising. The cons are unfortunate. Higher latencies, higher active energy, lower endurance, which is not an issue with DRAM in the past. There are actually some reliability issues as well, which I will not go into. But very briefly, I'll tell you, unfortunately, resistance is not stable either. Charge is not stable, but resistance is not stable. So it turns out there is this phenomenon called resistance drift. And it drifts, especially if you want to have multiple cells per bit. You can think of this as you cannot retain resistance. It's a little bit better than charge, but it still drifts. So there are a bunch of challenges enabling a new technology like this as a DRAM replacement or helper. First of all, how do you mitigate the shortcomings? How do you find the right way to place phase change memory in the system? And how do you ensure secure and fault-tolerant operation? Because this endurance problem can be a security problem also, right? One application can keep writing to memory and destroying half of your memory while other applications are trying to read from it. Right? Maybe it's not a protection. It's not an isolation problem in the sense that you cannot launch an attack. But it's kind of a wear-out attack, right? Your memory wears out over time. So it's good to think about some of these. Flash memory has these wear-out issues. And flash controllers are over-provisioned. So normally, when you buy flash memory, there's usually additional flash memory that's already present in the system, but that's not given to you. That part, so it's over-provisioned. Let's say you have 1 terabyte. It's really 1.5 terabytes. And internally, flash controllers use that memory when some part of the memory wears out. Right. Yes?
How about the cost of this?
Yeah, so that's always a good question. I don't have this over here. But cost today, with any emerging technology, cost is an issue, right? Because if you think about it, there has been a lot of investment in DRAM, actually. How many years? More than 50 years, right? And people have really driven down the cost by perfecting the manufacturing strategies. Whereas this technology, there's nothing that has been done. Well, nothing is perhaps unfair, but there's not much that has been done to perfect the cost for memory. So the cost today is very high. But the hope is that with scaling trends, and if there is enough effort put into it, the cost will scale. The same question actually arises with any technology. Flash memory, for example. When it first came out, it was extremely costly. Right? But then it's, people perfected the manufacturing processes. As a result, now its cost is very low. Right? Now it's actually, it was much costlier than DRAM when it first came out. And then over time, it was much less costly than DRAM. Now it cannot, flash memory cannot replace DRAM because it's latencies are extremely unfortunate, right, compared to DRAM. But that was the reason why it's adopted. Flash memory is now very cheap. In fact, there were times at which people were working on some academics in the 1990s were working on garbage collection for flash memories. And some people used to ridicule them. Why are you working on this technology that's never going to pan out? Well, garbage collection for flash memories are extremely important right now. Well, what is garbage collection for flash memories? Basically, it's exactly related to the wear-out problem, basically. Because things wear out, well, when you actually need to write to a block in flash, you need to erase the block. Right? You need to erase an entire block. And what flash memory does is it tries to hide this erase latency. It, for example, does the erase in the background. As a result, you need to actually collect some garbage over time. What are the erase blocks? What are the blocks that are dead? And you need to erase the blocks off the critical path. So these kind of algorithms actually affect the performance of these SSDs a lot. OK, anyway, I'm digressing right now. But cost is definitely a really important concern.
So
yes?
In case we reduce the cost of memory to a large extent, then can it replace both DRAM and the disk together?
So that's a great question, actually. Basically, it actually has nice properties that are better than disk. Yeah. Then the question is, can you actually somehow replace flash memory with this kind of technology? That's an easier problem, actually.
I'm just asking if it can replace DRAM and the disk, so you know we don't have a memory hierarchy at all.
Now you're getting ahead of me. We'll talk about that. That's right, exactly. That's So this kind of technology, assuming it pans out, you can actually replace both technologies potentially, right? Assuming the cost is good. Now that may be even more difficult, but it's good to think about it. So a lot of people are predicting that flash will replace disks, right? But it hasn't come down to that cost point yet. Disks are extremely cheap today, whereas flash is still expensive compared to disks. But maybe if time goes by and if disks also start having scaling problems, flash may be able to replace disks. Okay, there are many questions related to this. Basically, where do you place page change memory in the memory hierarchy? I'm not going to have answers to many of these, but this is just to jog your memory. Do you have an OS-controlled phase change memory and DRAM? Do you have OS-controlled phase change memory and hardware-controlled DRAM? Do you have pure phase change memory in main memory? How do you mitigate the shortcomings? How do you take advantage of fast non-volatile main memory? So let's take a look at this. This is kind of a cartoonish picture. This is what's today. Maybe this is what's in the short run. You have hybrid memories. And maybe this is what's, what it will look like in the long run. You have another technology replacing DRAM. And may not be, take this with a grain of salt, it may not be phase change memory. Right? It may be something else. So we'll talk about hybrid memories in a little bit, but there are a lot of challenges in this kind of system also. Some amount of your memory is DRAM, some amount of your memory is phase change memory, heterogeneous memory. So many questions. Actually, if you've attended today's lecture, it kind of talks about some of these questions. Should DRAM be a cache or main memory? Should the OS manage it? Should the hardware manage it? Should it be configurable? What fraction should be DRAM? What fraction should be something else? How many controllers do you have? How do you do the data allocation and movement? Who manages that? What are good control algorithms for this? And how do you prevent degradation of service due to wear out, right? A lot of questions. How do you design the cache hierarchy, memory controls, and the operating system to mitigate the shortcomings of this new technology while exploiting its advantages? And how do you actually rethink the design of the chips themselves now that you have these new requirements, right? Because these new requirements actually can drive the design of the chips too. Okay, let's take a look at this first, and I'll give you some numbers to see how you can approach the problem to begin with. Well, I guess before that, I'll digress a little bit. But this is another basically, what does it take to actually make phase change memory just the only technology to have in your memory? But let me actually talk about STT-MRAM a little bit, because phase change memory was very interesting at the time when a lot of people started looking at it as a replacement for main memory. But STT-MRAM is another very interesting technology that potentially is more advantageous compared to DRAM. So how does this work? Basically, you have this magnetic tunnel junction device. You can abstract it this way, and you can make it look like this way. Basically, you have a barrier, and you have two layers over here. And you have this reference layer with a field, fixed magnetic field. And this free layer's magnetic field can be parallel or anti-parallel to that reference layer. And if it's parallel, you can say this stores a logical zero. If it's anti-parallel, this stores a logical one. That's how you can distinguish. And basically, the cell looks similar. And this is how you read and write. Basically, to write, you need to push large current through this magnetic tunnel junction device such that you can flip the direction of the free layer. And it can actually, again, this needs to be a large current also. As a result, you expend a lot of energy to be able to do that. It's very interesting technology, and if you really want to know the guts of this, you can probably take a device class from Jimmy Zhu here. While you're at CMU, you can take advantage of it, right? Because he's actually developed a lot of these technologies. But what are the pros over DRAM? Similar to phase change memory. Better technology scaling, non-volatile, low idle power, no refresh. Cons are actually much better than phase change memory today. You get higher write latency and higher write energy, but you don't have the read latency and read energy problem. Reads are actually very fast from this STT-MRAM device. That's actually a really good thing, because read latency is very hard to hide, right? Write latency, you can do the writes off the critical path, perhaps. But reads are a lot harder to do off the critical path, because you need that data right away. Right? And there are some reliability questions, certainly. And there are actually other levels of freedom, which is really interesting. This is in part true for phase change memory, too. But you can actually trade off non-volatility for lower write latency and energy. If you reduce the size of this magnetic tunnel junction device, its volatility increases. But now, you don't need to drive as much current to flip the magnetic field. As a result, there's an interesting trade-off between volatility and write latency. You can reduce write latency and write energy by giving up some non-volatility. OK, it's just to jog your thinking a little bit. There are a lot of other technologies lurking in the future, right now, and maybe farther into the future, there may be other technologies. So it's good to think about these. And this is the right time to think about it because we are actually having these scaling problems. Let's take a look at what happens if you take phase change memory and replace DRAM with phase change memory. I'm going to assume these values. So high latencies, read and write, high energies, read and write, but especially write, and endurance problems. So if you replace DRAM, this is again simulation, and take the simulation with a grain of salt. We talked a lot about the accuracy of simulation, right? Well, accuracy of simulation with an existing technology and with a known design is already a problem. Now you have an emerging technology whose parameters, some parameters are unknowns, right? How do you do that simulation? Well, you can do that simulation, but you got to do the processing of the results very carefully. So if you replace DRAM with phase change memory in a system that has 4 cores and 4 megabyte L2, these are the results that you get. And I'll summarize the results very quickly. You get 60% performance degradation on these applications, energy increased by 120%, and your memory dies after 500 hours. Sounds bad, right? Dies meaning because of the wear out issues, right? Your endurance problems. So you don't want a technology like this, certainly. Well, how can you actually fix the problem? You can actually try to, there are many ways. I'm not going to go into details, but one thing that's interesting here that you should understand at this point is DRAM, you have this large row buffer, right? And you have the sense amplifier. In phase change memory, in DRAM, this is volatile. In phase change memory, this is non-volatile. There's no reason to store the entire row buffer in somewhere, right? Because it's all non-volatile. Once you read it, you can actually store a little chunk of it in some buffer over here. Make sense? So what you can do actually, you can, instead of having a one large row buffer, you can actually chop it into smaller buffers. As a result, you can actually do better caching over here. I'm not going to go into detail. That's one potential thing you can do. The other potential thing you can do is you can actually write into the array at a smaller granularity than DRAM. Because writing into the array is a bad idea. So this array is good for capacity, but accessing it, especially writing to it, is a bad idea. Because writes lead to wear, and writes also increase your energy. So we'd like to minimize the amount of writes. How do you minimize the amount of writes? First of all, you can do better caching over here before the chip, before the array. And second, write only the necessary data that you need to write, which means that write the data that's modified. Right? Today, when we do writes into DRAM, it's at a cache block granularity. What if you change only one bit in that cache block, right? You're really wasting a lot of writes. In phase change memory, you can actually do that level of writes, bit level writes. Okay, if you do these and some other optimizations, life looks much better. Basically, if you do these optimizations, you can reduce the performance degradation compared to DRAM to 20%. Energy becomes on par with DRAM. And I believe this is actually a problem with the model. So your simulation models may not be accurate. That also says don't believe everything you read. Right? the lifetime is 5.6 years. Right? Basically, it looks much more promising, right? This way. The problem is the worst case lifetime is much shorter. Right? If you look at this, how do you guarantee a 5.6-year lifetime? Well, you cannot. That's the downside. With this wear out problem, you cannot do it. And intensive applications, if you're really memory intensive, this leads to a lot of performance loss. And maybe the parameters are not right over here. So with emerging technologies, these are always the questions that you should ask yourself. So this is why a hybrid memory system may make a lot of sense. Right? Maybe this technology is not good on its own, but if you couple it with some amount of DRAM, and if you intelligently manage DRAM and phase change memory together, you get a much better system. Then the key question is, how do you actually use DRAM? How do you use phase change memory? And very quickly, one option is you can use phase change memory as part of your main memory. Now it becomes your main memory. And DRAM can be your cache. And it could be hardware managed. And if you attend to today's talk, it talked about how to build hardware managed caches. Right? The upside is now on a DRAM cache hit, you get reduced latency. And DRAM actually can be a huge write buffer. Right? You keep writing to DRAM and buffer things until you coalesce a lot of writes and then push that into phase change memory such that you minimize the number of writes to this technology. In fact, this is exactly what your SSDs do. Right? in your SSDs, in your flash controllers, you have a good chunk of DRAM that's used as a buffer. Why? Because writing to flash memory has the same problem. It wears out. And an SSD, this is all invisible to you, obviously. An SSD internally has its DRAM buffer that it uses to not only minimize the number of writes into the device, but also service some requests much faster, right? You can actually do a good caching in that SSD. Right? Now you need to be careful, of course. You need to ensure that, because this data is supposed to be persistent, right? And the DRAM is volatile. So how do you ensure that in the presence of power loss, you get the correct data in your SSD? Well, sometimes you may lose power, especially in these little USB flash drives that are made of the cheapest flash components. You may actually lose data. So I would suggest replicating your data on those devices. And make sure that you don't expose them to very, very high temperatures. You may have issues. Because all of the retention issues that you have in DRAM also exist in flash memory. Okay, anyway, that was the digression. But these techniques are actually applied in other contexts today, in SSDs, for example, because very similar problems exist. But can we actually do that at the memory level? So memory controller hardware can manage the DRAM cache. This eliminates a lot of system software overhead, actually. So if you have a large DRAM cache that's very fast latency, you don't want to have the operating system manage the movement of data between a similar latency structure like phase change memory and the DRAM. Okay, so there are three issues. What data should be placed in DRAM versus kept in phase change memory? What is the granularity of data movement? That's what was tackled in today's talk. How do you design a huge DRAM cache at low cost? That's also tackled in today's talk. I'm not going to talk about these, but you can actually build cheap tag stores, and you can dynamically decide the granularity of management. And you can imagine how to do that. Again, I'm not going to talk about these because we don't have time. Let's actually look at one thing that's fundamental to many devices, which is locality-aware data placement. So if you have this small DRAM cache and huge phase change memory, what data do you place here and what data do you place here? One thing you can say is, I want to place my frequently accessed data in the DRAM cache. Right? And that makes sense because it's much lower latency. Right? That may be a good idea. But what if your frequently accessed data can be accessed at the same speed as at the same speed if you place it in phase change memory? Then you don't want to waste valuable DRAM space, right? So the observation is that if you have row buffers, and row buffers are very fundamental to any technology, you need to buffer what you read first before pushing it out of the device. The row buffers are the same in DRAM and phase change memory. They're really cross-coupled inverters. They're really SRAM, fundamentally. As a result, this row buffer hit latency is the same in DRAM and PCM. Whereas row buffer miss or conflict latency is small in DRAM because this array is really DRAM cells, whereas this array over here is phase change memory cells. That's much slower. So the realization is that accessing the row buffer in phase change memory is fast as DRAM. What incurs high latency is the phase change memory array access. So somehow avoid this. Okay, so that's the idea over here. Basically, because row buffers are the same, if you keep hitting on the row buffers, then keep the data in phase change memory, right? Don't waste valuable DRAM space with it, because you're going to get the same latency and same bandwidth out of phase change memory as with DRAM. Only cache in DRAM rows that cause a lot of row conflicts and that are reused many times. So what do you want to cache in DRAM? Things that cannot be accessed as fast in phase change memory, and things that matter, that are reused many times. If you're using some memory location only once, there's no reason to waste space in DRAM, right? So again, we're going back to the caching lecture, right? That's why caches are so fundamental. That's why people have been working on caches for 60 years or so. And they're going to keep working on caches. But simplify rule of thumb, and this is actually simplified across the entire memory hierarchy, if you will. Whenever you're doing a streaming access, if you're streaming through the row buffer, for example, it's better to place that data into phase change memory. And again, this is if all you're doing is streaming from memory, you can design a totally different memory hierarchy than today. You don't really need caches, right? Because caches, you just need to stream data in and stream data out somehow. You need to have very good streaming buffers, again, I want to stretch your mind a little bit. How do you? It's always good to think about extremes. There is a streaming access. All you're doing is streaming. There is this random access. All you're doing is random access. It's good to think about how you design a memory hierarchy for just streaming and how you design a memory hierarchy for just random access. If all you're doing is streaming across huge data sets, think about video streaming. You're streaming at like terabytes and terabytes of video. What's the point of having caches? No point, right? You don't have any locality, any temporal locality. Spatial locality you can exploit by prefetching. Right? You can actually always go to the disk, very high latency, but if you have enough buffering, when you pull YouTube, you see buffering, right? If your internet connection is slow. If you have enough buffering, you can tolerate that long latency to the hard disk. If all you're doing is streaming, you don't need an expensive memory technology. That's what we're exploiting over here. Basically, it's better to place the data in PCM if you're doing streaming. If you have other access with some reuse, now you can actually use your expensive technology for it, DRAM, right? If you're doing purely random access, well, what do? You have no locality. That's something for you to think about. I don't know what's the best hierarchy for that kind of thing. There you really want to reduce your latency, right? But then you really want to reduce your random access latency. You really want the technology that's really, really fast if all you're doing is pure random access, because you cannot exploit any kind of locality. OK, so let's take a look at some results. Basically, if you do this row locality aware data placement, so these are some results showing some workloads over here. And these are averages. And this is performance on the y-axis. And this is frequency-based caching. So frequently used data goes into DRAM. And you determine the thresholds dynamically. Dyn means thresholds are determined dynamically. So if you do frequency-based caching, actually, you get good performance, reasonable performance, let's say. If you do row buffer locality-aware caching, you actually get much better performance. Basically, if you take into account this existence of row buffers and determine streaming access versus random accesses and place the data accordingly, you get much better performance. By the way, I said that you can design a memory controller that can detect this, but you can actually think about software at the high level doing this. So management of hybrid memories are important today, because as you, if you attend the talk today, these hybrid memories are already here. Right? You have this 3D stack DRAM, and then you have this real DRAM. And NVIDIA, for example, uses 3D stack DRAM, right, today. But that's not all of your memory. You have your DRAM as your main memory. Then the key question is, what do you place in 3D stack DRAM? What do you place in your, I don't want to call it real DRAM, but main memory DRAM? Right? So maybe you can actually figure out streaming versus random access patterns or other reuse patterns. And the programmer or the software stack can tell you, oh, these are the streaming things. So you should place it into the memory that you're not going to waste as much. There's no, usually doesn't make sense to place streaming access patterns, easy access patterns, to expensive inexpensive memory. OK. So where does this bring us? Very quickly, this is assuming you have 16 gigabyte phase change memory, 16 gigabyte DRAM. This is the huge performance differential, if you look at it. This doesn't take into account any scaling benefits that you would get. Maybe you can argue that a fair, more fair comparison into the future could be comparing 16 gigabyte DRAM with 64 gigabyte PCM, right? Assuming PCM is really less costly going into the future. But we're not doing that. We're assuming equal size memory here. If you actually use this hybrid memory management scheme, you kind of bridge the gap. But you're not perfectly at the performance level of 16 gigabyte DRAM, unfortunately. So there is more work to be done. And this work is real because you already have these hybrid memories. Maybe the technology is a little bit different. It's not phase change memory. Maybe it's slower DRAM, faster DRAM, right? So you'll actually probably need to manage slower and faster DRAM going into the future, unless NVIDIA does a really good job managing it for you. But maybe you'll be working at NVIDIA doing this, right? OK. So in the last 1 minute, I guess I'll keep you so that we can finish this quickly and then move on to multiprocessors next time. I'll talk about some other opportunities, and this will cover some of what you said. Basically, once we have these technologies, we can imagine other things, right? Can we somehow merge memory and storage? These are non-volatile, right? Can we somehow have a single interface to manage all the data? This is where you should relax and think about potential things. Can we have new applications? Maybe we can have ultra-fast checkpoint and restore, right? Boot up will be fast. That's probably easy to imagine. Can we have more robust system designs? What if everything is non-volatile? Maybe you have L1 cache that's But STT-MRAM actually is a really good technology to implement on-chip as well. You can have on-chip non-volatile caches. If those are all non-volatile, maybe power loss becomes less of an issue, right? Maybe you'll have these devices that operate with very little power. And maybe you can do processing tightly coupled with memory. We'll not talk about that, but some technologies combine logic and memory together. Let's take a look at this very quickly, because this kind of gives you an idea of what an emerging technology can potentially do or let you imagine. So if you look at a system today, all of the systems that I know of look like this. You access main memory, which stores volatile data, using this very accelerated interface called the load store interface that we've optimized through the rest of this course, right, earlier. It's accelerated heavily in hardware. You have this virtual memory, and you do TLB accesses, address translation, very quickly. And it's evolved this way because this is really fast. Whereas if you look at this part, the persistent data is stored in the storage devices, but the interface you use it to access it is really different. You use the file system calls, right? You open a file, you read from the file, you write to the file, and then you close the file. And all of those actually underneath the system moves the data into the DRAM and does the operation in DRAM and then moves the data back into the storage. And this has a lot of overhead. Basically, there's a lot of overhead in going through the operating system and file system calls. And in 2.13, hopefully you remember you've done some of these, right? But this has a lot of overhead. But this overhead is tolerable if the latency of the storage device is huge. If it's milliseconds and milliseconds and milliseconds, maybe it's OK to do one more millisecond over here, right? But if you replace this with phase change memory or something like that, some persistent memory, now this is not milliseconds and milliseconds. This is hundreds of nanoseconds. And if you're doing a millisecond of operation over here, then you have a problem, right? You're really not taking advantage of the speed of the technology over here. This actually, people are already finding this out with SSDs today. SSDs are actually really fast. But you're really bottlenecked by the operating system and file system code you need to go through to access the SSD. If you can directly access SSD somehow today, you can actually get much better performance. But we're not able to do that today. Well, as an architect, you can actually rethink some of those abstractions too. So basically, operating system and file system code to locate, translate, and buffer data become performance and energy bottlenecks with this fast, persistent memory stores. So can you actually fix this problem? And this is very similar to the idea you mentioned. Basically, can you somehow unify the memory and storage management in a single unit to eliminate all of that wasted work? The hope is that this improves both energy and performance. And hopefully, this will simplify the programming model as well. Maybe you don't have two different interfaces. Imagine everything as load store accessible. You do a load to a file and then store to a file. Right? Maybe you need to be a little bit more. You may need other abstractions because you've got to be careful, right? This is persistent data. What if your program is wrong and you store to a file? Well, you corrupted the persistent data. That may not be a good thing. Okay, so that's the idea. How do you actually design this? I'm not going to go over this, but this is the potential thing that you can have with emerging technologies. You can expose a load store interface directly to the applications. Applications can directly access this persistent memory. You can manage data placement, location, and security, dot, dot, dot. I'm not going to go over this. You can take a look at this. But imagine the future this kind of technologies can bring to you. If you have technologies that are really fast, like DRAM, but also non-volatile, like phase change memory, STT-MRAM, and other technologies have their place too. If you can access everything with loads and stores, and maybe with some other hints telling the security properties of the data, you can actually have a much better system, perhaps. And maybe you have a different programming model. How many of you have programmed with persistent objects? Whenever you declared an array, it's a persistent. No? Well, I don't either. This doesn't exist today. But it may make sense to think about it going into the future, right? If you have a really fast, non-volatile memory that's accessible at the byte level, then you may actually declare an array that's persistent, right? It's a persistent object. And when your program crashes in the middle, well, next time you start the program, you start from right that point, right? Assuming you have the system abstractions to enable this, right? Does that make sense? Yes? But still at the file system level, right?
But if you declare an array and then crash, it will be there.
Exactly, yes, that's right, that's right. So you can actually do it at a very high abstraction layer. You could potentially do it. You're right. Now you can actually use that abstraction level and drive it into memory. So that's done at storage devices, and the system kind of handles it. How do you drive it to memory such that you can exploit these technologies is definitely interesting. So there are, at the higher abstraction level, there are similar examples. Yes? So this is actually not a new idea. Maybe we should have a lesson on history also. The earliest computers did not have this distinction, two-level model. The Atlas computer, for example, it has a single unit, load stores, and everything was accessible like that. So actually, you're right. Some of the some of these could be very useful for functional languages. But let's not go into that, because I'm not sure if everybody knows about functional languages here. You don't need to. OK. So what are the benefits of this? I'll give you the benefits very quickly. These are simulation results again. This is for one workload. But this is the execution time of this workload with a hard disk. Most of the time, the workload is waiting for the hard disk. This is really bound by the storage. If you actually replace that hard disk with something like phase change memory, that's the performance you get, 24x. Sounds good, right? But your bottleneck now shifts. If you here, the bottleneck was really the device access time, because the device was so slow. Here, the bottleneck is now system software. You're really spending, well, if you actually zoom into this, you're really spending most of your time on system calls. Well, if you actually get rid of those system calls somehow with a single level store, this is actually called single level stores. It's not a new idea. But now it may be an idea that may need to be re-examined in the presence of emerging technologies. In fact, I'll give you another thing. IBM has a system called AS400. And their goal was exactly the same at that time. Can we actually somehow design a system where all the data is load store accessible, persistent data? And there's a really nice paper. What was the name of the person? By an IBM engineer. Ah, I need some food. It's called Inside the AS400. Frank, somebody can search for it and tell me what the name is. Frank Soltis. Has a really nice paper, Inside the AS400. I would definitely recommend that. And we should probably put that up on the website. Actually, even better, for the extra credit winners, I'm going to get that book for the next lab. Inside the AS400, that's a really good book about system design, how they designed the AS400 system. That actually, their goal was to have the single level store. And they actually designed the single level store. But their technologies were, of course, not as fast. They actually accessed the disk at the single level store to eliminate all of these overheads. But there's a lot of potential benefit you can get. And this is the energy benefit, by the way. If you actually replace hard disks with something like phase change memory, you get a lot of energy benefit. If you get rid of the two-level model, manage everything with loads and stores, you get even more benefit. And by the way, none of these simulations over here assume that you have DRAM in the system. If you add DRAM in the system and manage the data intelligently, you can get even better performance on top of this. So there are many issues on, this is my last slide for today. Basically, if you have a technology like this, it really changes the way you think about how the entire computing stack is designed, right? Because you're really changing the fundamental memory over here. How do you enable it, first of all? How do you tolerate the errors? And errors actually wear out, for example. How do you enable secure operation is important, again, because of wear out. How do you tolerate the performance and power shortcomings? And how do you minimize the cost? And there's also the other side of it. How do you exploit these technologies? How do you actually exploit non-volatility? Basically, what I talked about earlier is really important. Can you merge memory and storage, for example? How do you minimize energy consumption? And if you have this on-chip, if you have on-chip non-volatile memory, how do you exploit it on-chip? These are some questions that you may want to think about going forward, because the future may look very much like this for you guys, especially. I guess I'll keep you with one more slide, because this is really important. In the end, we have three principles, really. Basically, to scale memory, including DRAM, into the future, you need to have better cooperation between the device and the system. And we've already seen this, right? Refresh rate, heterogeneous refresh rates, for example, RADR. You need to have flexible interfaces for that also. This is something we'll talk about more, but you need to really do better than worst case design. You shouldn't optimize worst case. So if you optimize a worst case refresh, you see that you'll actually waste a lot of energy. But if you actually figure out what is the common case and the optimize the refresh for the common case and refresh the worst case stuff maybe less frequently or maybe not use it, you can actually get much better system design. And heterogeneity, actually. Heterogeneity in design almost always enables an efficient design, assuming that you can actually control these heterogeneous components, manage these heterogeneous components well. This is also called specialization and asymmetry, right? You can see this in the processor design space too. Processors are becoming increasingly more heterogeneous. You have all these accelerators, GPUs, big cores, small cores. That enables a much more efficient design overall. The downside, it increases the complexity. But that's actually a fundamental principle for scaling memory as well. And these principles are actually related and sometimes coupled. And I'll let you think about that. For example, if you add heterogeneity into the system, you probably want to have better cooperation between your hardware and the software to manage the heterogeneous memory, right? If you want to do better than worst-case design, if you want to adapt your refresh rate, again, you may want to have better cooperation between device and the system, because how do you figure out the refresh rates for different parts? Okay? Okay, this is where I'll stop. We're already over time, but I'll buy you more time in the next lecture. Okay, next time we'll start with multiprocessors.